defined by OTA in the architectural reference model. And in the case of SocIoTal, authorization is actually instantiated by different access control technologies and by different hardware components, as we will see later. In the case of access control technologies, authorization in SocIoTal is based on SACMEL, the standard for access control, for the definition of access control policies. And in this case, we are using an implementation based on JSON to be a little bit more lightweight. And these authorization decisions that we obtain with SACMEL, we are using those decisions to generate or not authorization credentials based on the approach based on capabilities. Basically, in the case of you are authorized to do something about a specific device, you will get an authorization credential in this case with decatback, and you can use this credential directly to get access or to do something about for a device. In the case of these authorization credentials based on the capabilities, this is one of the main results about authorization from SocIoTal. We are using a token representation with JSON. We are using these credentials as a new header in CoAP, and this communication is secure using ECCLT cool cryptography for that. And in this case, we are using these authorization credentials as a lightweight and flexible mechanism to deal with access control issues in the case of Babel or groups or communities, Babel and communities in SocIoTal. This is an example of decatback for decatback token. This is I think it's maybe it's better if you can take a look to the GitHub with a whole description of these fields. But this is the result of we will see in the scenario a capability client that will apply for a capability token to make access. In this case, we have a specific device. It's a sensor, temperature sensor, and you can get a decatback token associated to the. In this case, the access right is to get the temperature from that sensor, and you can use these credentials to get directly the temperature from that sensor. And in this case, we will see a demo. It's based, it's using smartphones, but actually this approach, actually we have some implementations even with more constrained devices with Contiki modes. So you can use it in not only for smartphones, but also for more constrained IoT devices. Regarding the authorization components that are required for authorization purposes in SocIoTal, we have a typical more typical policy decision point based on SACMEL to make authorization decisions. This is an entity that is currently running in the University of Murcia. We have a policy administration point. This is a point for users can define access control policies about their devices. The capability manager, that is another entity that is currently running the University of Murcia, that it is responsible for generating these authorization credentials based on decatback. And this is not part of the infrastructure. That is part that this is the part of devices capability client that will apply for the decatback tokens to the capability manager, and after that it will be able to use those credentials to get access to another entity acting as a capability verifier. This is basically the whole scenario of the authorization in SocIoTal. We have a capability client acting as a CoAP DTLS client, and this entity wants to get access to a specific resource hosted by this device acting as a capability verifier and CoAP DTLS server. And first of trying to get access to that device, it will apply for a DGATBACK token to the capability manager. This this communication is based on Quad DTLS, it's a certificate-based authentication. And when the capability manager obtains the request from the capability client, it will request, it will query the policy decision point to get an authorization decision for that request. And in the case of a permit decision from the PDP, the capability manager will generate a DGATBACK token for the capability client to get access in a authorized way to the resource hosted by the capability verifier. Okay, I don't know if you have any questions.
In the example, there is GET, but is it working also with this approach of subscribing the data? So when the subscriber wants to subscribe the data,
In this case, we are trying to get tokens for a specific, not in the case of public subscribe. Okay. This is the another demo for the secure group communications too.
But nonetheless, you also need an authorization token to access to the contest manager in order to subscribe.
If
you want to subscribe to a particular entity, you will need a token that is going to be evaluated by the context manager. So authorization is also with access to the context manager.
Okay. So how do you handle revocation?
Revocation is
We are using expiration. I mean this fields in the token, not before and not after, but not a specific mechanism for revocation. Right?
Why didn't you use NGSI already?
We are not using NGSI here.
Yeah, that's the question. Why?
Why?
Yeah.
That we are using, I don't know.
It's RESTful API. But you chose to use a firewire context broker.
No, but you can get a capability token from the capability manager and using with NGCI to get access to the context broker.
Yeah.
So you can do that.
Maybe. That's many protocols in one.
So I don't know. But no, I mean it's quite, it's HTTP and this is core, but it's.
I didn't show you, but in the API test that I did, one of the headers were the topic.
Yes.
That's what it is.
Did you do any performance measurements? How much overhead it is?
Even for
some papers of this with performance results and so on. If you can, I can show you the papers and so on.
Is this finished?
This is just the a short demo, a very simple demo about that, and. Thank you.
It's okay.
So we have two different mobiles here, and we are just going to show a demo to where the token is used to access from one smartphone to the other one.
So in this case, that mobile phone, that smartphone is acting as a capability verifier, and this capability client that will try to get a capability token to get access. In this case, it's a very simple demo to get access to the location of his smartphone.
With that phone, it's going to access to my location, but it will firstly obtain a proper authorization token, and then. Access touching that token to my smartphone. My smartphone acts as a verifier, can verify the signature and the token, and see if the access right are right in the token. Well, just verify the token. It's very, very simple. You can do something like that during these days. So it's a server in my smartphone up and running in that IP. And
so now I'm trying to get a capability token. I don't know if it's very difficult, but it's a requested token, and this entity has obtained a capability token to get access to that entity, and I can do I can use that credential to get access to the. This is the.
Yes, so in that we have a new request from that device that he's accessing my location.
And
that's it. Really simple demo.
It's very simple. And
he's accessing my coordinates, my location.
As I already mentioned, the approach is not only for in this case for smartphones, but it can be used with any kind of device for authorization purposes, and even the way to generate tokens, and it can be flexible.
The authorization part was done in the phone, in the mobile phone. They said the authorization is made in the PDP, which is the entity that evaluates the authorization. So the server performs the authorization, then generates the token, and you once you have the token, you can use the same token once again, unless it's revoked.
Actually, the smartphone is acting as a policy enforcement point of the
PDP.
Of the decision. Of
the smartphone asks for the server about token, and then the other phone with information that he wants to have.
Yeah, the thing is that the verifier that receives the token trusts, of course, the PDP that made the decision, and since the token is signed by the issuer, then. He only has to verify the signature. That's it.
But just say all these components, where are they? Verifier, where is it? In mobile phone or in the server?
The verifier?
Yes.
In the smartphone.
Smartphone, okay. Yeah. And
so it's a end-to-end, machine-to-machine direct communication. During the once you get the token, the server is not required any longer.
Okay.
You are access directly between two devices.
So we can steal the token somehow to get access to other devices?
No, of course. You need to demonstrate that you are the entity associated to that token. In this case, we are using the access rights actually are associated to the public key of the subject entity.
This is the subject entity?
So
is it the public certificate?
Yes.
You
so
need
that, since you are using your certificate to access to that device, he can verify that you are the subject.
I mean, you need to demonstrate that you have the private key associated to the public key. So,
so it's authentication as well.
Yeah.
Isn't any timeout for the token? So, for example, when I have no connection to the authorization server for some time, will it be somehow? The possibility of getting value will be forbidden, or it will be working.
No, but you don't need always the connectivity with the capability manager to get the token. If you have a value,
if I have a token, then I can connect directly to the second device.
Yeah.
But assuming that. After a while, someone would like to get rid of my access, and with this, I can still connect to the second device.
But
you're talking about revocation, or
yeah.
Since that if there will be some revocation, the issuer should notify the entities that that token is not any longer.
Okay, so there is no timeout mechanism for the
revocation is not handled, it's not going to work. By the time being, we support time for revocation, in the token. And if we, in the future, perhaps it's a matter of the server to notify the target list, telling them that the token is not valid any longer.